Just to give you a brief understanding how exactly the Lean Startup movement began. The pioneers of the Lean movement are the gentleman on the left, who is known as Steve Black. He is a well-established serial entrepreneur in Silicon Valley. He is a reputed academician, and he came up with the novel concept of customer development methodology. What customer development is all about, we'll be actually delving into it as the presentation goes on. This was a basic concept which appealed to many budding entrepreneurs, many established entrepreneurs who had their own startup up and running but were facing numerous kind of challenges. And one of those students was a man who I think was Eric Ries. Eric Ries applied most of the concept that Steve Lang taught, and he actually was running his own venture, which is known as IMView. If some of you have actually explored it, it's 3D animated virtual world. It has been very popular for quite some time. He had a hard time in actually getting the product up and running, and he faced a lot of challenges with customers, and he applied some of the lessons learned, not just from Steve Lang, but from his own mistakes during his time there. And he basically pioneered the Lean Startup concept. Today, the Lean movement, which began in Silicon Valley, has crossed all over the world, as you can see. It spans now 50 countries with more than 180,000 members. As you can see, this is a huge grassroots community which is providing peer-to-peer mentorship to entrepreneurs all across the world. It's not necessary that people travel huge distances. Today, with technology, you can actually set up a Google Hangout, you can have different kind of knowledge exchange programs. And yeah, the group has been growing ever since. Now, before I actually delve into what exactly the Lean Startup is all about, just to give you a brief overview of what its principles are. See, the concept of Lean Startup is a huge topic. You have a lot of concepts which, if you try to delve into detail, it's not possible to cover it in a short span of 45-minute session. But I'll try my best to give you an overview of what exactly it is about and what you can expect in our next coming future events. First of all, the main core belief of a Lean Startup is that entrepreneurs are everywhere. Normally, we have this understanding that entrepreneur is a person who builds his company from scratch. He takes certain amount of financial risk to actually bring his idea to fruition and tries to build or scale his business so as to actually establish his brand or establish his product in the worldwide market. Not necessarily. There is another form of entrepreneur which is known as intrapreneur that work in huge organizations. People which brave in initiatives, they would actually like to bring certain ideas into fruition, you know, so as to bring more profit to the company. Usually they come across certain kind of bureaucratic challenges in the organization, whether it's politics or very stringent processes. But the basic concept is that it's not just an individual who starts his own business. You can apply some of these concepts within your organization depending on the support of your management. When you talk about management, entrepreneurship has to do with some management principles as well as some basic principles related to accounting as well. Usually we tend to relate management accounting to traditional concepts which are taught in business schools, and very few of us actually try to apply it in the field of a startup as a young entrepreneur, because basically when you begin your own individual entity in this huge competitive world, you want to avoid any kind of bureaucracy or any kind of stringent processes that you have faced while working for a huge organization. And you actually believe in being lean, absolutely slim and flexible. So the concepts of traditional management and traditional accounting practices don't really gel well with entrepreneurs. But what the Lean Startup has taught many developing entrepreneurs as well as successfully established entrepreneurs that entrepreneurship has a lot to do with managing, as well as trying to measure the efficiency of the people who form a part of your team. And we'll be seeing that shortly, how exactly to do it. Some of the concepts which some of you have come across in your own personal learning about lean startups, that is validated learning, build, measure, and learn, we'll be covering these topics as well. Now, first of all, a doubt which runs through many people's mind. What is a startup? What is the proper definition of a startup? I've been part of a lot of discussion forums and blogs which dwell on this topic, and what I have understood is there's no single definition for a startup. So here I'll try to attempt what Eric Ries has defined about a startup. It's a human institution designed to deliver a product or service under conditions of extreme uncertainty. What happens is many founders tend to have this ideology that a startup revolves around a product, a breakthrough technology. They think that's what it's all about. Not necessarily. If you have a deep insight into what it takes to build a startup, it's nothing but a human institution. It's the pool, the human capital pool that you actually employ, the initial founding team, which forms the core essence of a startup, which tries to bring the idea to fruition and basically appeal to different customers, or depending on the choice of customer segment you're choosing, to deliver a certain product or service of value. Normally people tend to have this confusion, alright, fine, I get it, startup is about a human institution, but when does it cease to be a startup? When does it become a full-scale business? There are multiple factors. There's no single point that you can look upon and decide that, yes, this is no longer a startup, it's become a full-scale business. It could depend on multiple factors, like, first of all, the metrics that you're using to measure the progress of the startup. It could also depend on probably the market size that you're targeting. Also, it could depend upon the kind of acquisition that's taking place. Nowadays, we keep hearing about many young fledgling startups being acquired by big organizations like Google and Yahoo for a pretty handsome sum. So, yeah, even then, they could cease to be a startup. They become part of a well-established organization. Sometimes it depends on you, the founder, the entrepreneur. Several entrepreneurs, they like to maintain the environment of a startup. They don't want to become another big full-scale organization where, again, you have to go through the traditional management practices. No, they like to maintain that. So even if one single person leaves the company or the team, it makes no difference. There are multiple factors. The other question that I keep getting is that, okay, Google used to be a startup once upon a time. Now it's become a huge organization. But I have seen that recently, with the progress of time, some of their products have failed. We have heard about it, like Google Wave, Google Buzz. So then we see certain other ventures which come out within the organization, like Google Plus, trying to target the social media segment. So is that a miniature startup within a big organization? Or let's say Facebook, for example. Facebook comes out with new features rolled over during certain periods of time. The team which is running that particular feature, like recently they announced, they're going to introduce a search graph, which will help you to search what exactly your friends are, where they're hanging out, or different interests related to the particular region. So that particular team which is running the search graph, is that a miniature startup within Facebook? Can say so. True. It all depends on the leadership. What I have understood and what many entrepreneurs have actually discussed about this is, usually it depends on the leadership of the organization, whether they want to diversify their portfolio in terms of whether they want to stick to a certain goal, a certain ideology that they began with. Like, one interesting extract that I can tell you from the book called The Innovator's Dilemma, the author Clayton, he mentioned a very interesting point. Some organizations, they reach a point of scalability where they are not building breakthrough innovation products. They're just building products which are points of sustainable innovation. They're just adding new features, you know, new kind of, like, you can look at the iPhone from Apple, which is, many people are criticizing that it's not matching up to some of the innovative features that Samsung is coming up. It's a topic of debate. There are people who support Apple's methodology of rolling out the product, as there's some people who like Samsung's way of testing out new things with customers in a different manner. What you have to understand is that when an organization reaches a certain point of scalability where it is finding difficult to bring out new innovative products, it tries to build what you call islands of freedom. The leadership takes an initiative where they want to give certain amount of freedom to people within the organization who have good ideas. They would like to basically differentiate from what the organization is doing, and they would like to test out a new methodology. Some of the initiatives we have seen, for example, a company which is known as Intuit. It is a company which runs financial software. They came out with one of the products, which is QuickBooks, which was basically built out of the same concept. They allowed certain people who had entrepreneurial streaks within them, and they gave them the full support to go and test out a new product. And what the leadership actually believed in is that you don't need to bring superstar entrepreneurs from outside the company. There are people within the organization who have good ideas. They know much better about your product than someone from outside. So why not give them the amount of resources they need to actually go ahead and test out the idea and see what kind of returns it gets. So, coming back to the definition of startup, as you can see, it has nothing to do with the size of the company. It has nothing to do with the sector of the economy or the industry. A startup is an idea which is running in the brains of an entrepreneur who wants to test it out as quickly as possible with minimum amount of investment. Basically, what the entrepreneur is doing, he's running the startup as an experiment to test his hypothesis about an idea. He would like to see whether this idea is appealing to certain customers that they're trying to target. Basically, what you're trying to build is trying to build a product or service that stops wasting people's time. Why do customers basically want something that you build? It's because it helps them to fulfill one of their goals with minimum amount of effort and less amount of time taken from their side. Now, when we talk about startups, we recently heard about Yahoo's acquisition of Tumblr, Google's acquisition of WhatsApp, a simple messaging application on many of the smartphones, Facebook's acquisition of Instagram, a simple photo app, photography application which runs on the smartphones. When we keep listening about all these successful acquisitions and overnight billionaires, we tend to think, yeah, sure, I can do that as well. And I have a very good idea, I have the capabilities, I have the experience in my industry, why not give it a shot? What many people fail to realize is that for each successful startup out there, there are several failures as well. The entrepreneurial journey, although it's pretty exciting, at the same time it can be pretty daunting, it can be pretty tough, and for some, it has not been a very successful venture. For some, on the other hand, they have learned from their mistakes, from their first venture, applied those concepts in their second venture, being successful to a certain extent, and then maybe they have hit the jackpot in the next forthcoming one. As they say that success is the path to success. It's not a straight line. It's a lot of ups and downs, zigzag. It all depends on how exactly you venture out, what kind of decisions you take in your startup. Mostly what the Lean Startup tries to teach people is how to test out your idea with minimum amount of features being built in your product, as well as less amount of time and capital invested for this. And we're going through this now exactly. So as I was saying, many startups, they achieve failure. They're usually building something that nobody wants. And it doesn't matter if they build it within the stipulated timelines, within the defined budget, with very good quality, or let's say with beautiful design. It really doesn't matter if it doesn't appeal to your customer. At the end of the day, what you've done is you've successfully executed a bad plan. Now, when we're talking about the concept that entrepreneurship is about management, what we're trying to understand here is that your end long-term goal is not just building a single product or a particular service. You're trying to build an institution. You're trying to build a company with a team of people who can basically carry forward the idea that you began with, the principles that you began with, so as to see where exactly the journey takes you. For example, Facebook, which began from a small dormitory room. Today, it's become a hugely successful product. And you have to understand that it was not the first company that came up with the concept of a social network. There were other attempts as well. What exactly it takes to run a so-called startup? See, many people who have been through business schools, they have come across many kinds of concepts such as organizational behavior, financial accounting, sales and channel management, business-to-business market strategy. These are pretty well-respected subjects and they are pretty well-recognized, but you have to understand that these are concepts which are applicable for an already established and full-fledged organization which has a presence in the market. When you talk about building a startup, something from scratch, many of the concepts which work in traditional management methodology need not necessarily work here. You have to take a different kind of approach. Basically, what you have to do is you have to apply certain practices and principles which apply to the idea of a concept of a startup, which is it operates in the condition of extreme uncertainty. See, after the 2008 financial crisis, where many employees were actually laid off, some of them decided to start their own ventures, some business schools actually understood the essence of entrepreneurship and they started introducing the entrepreneurship course in the curriculum. But any experienced person will tell you that what's taught in the business school is basically theoretical concepts. If you really want to understand whether your idea or whatever thought you're having, whether it works, it's to go and test it out in the practical world. And the lessons learned from the practical world are any day more valuable than what you learn in a theory class. Of course, the theoretical class prepares you to go and face the practical. So, how exactly the Lean Revolution began and how did this approach concepts which are different from traditional management practices? First of all, the term Lean is not something which is unique to high technology startups. It didn't begin from there. It began quite a while back in the manufacturing industry, especially in the automobile industry. Some of the pioneers about the Lean Revolution were people like Edward Deming and Taishi Ono, who used to work for Toyota. Both these gentlemen are not alive today, but their work in this field has been a kind of a benchmark which has taught many people how to apply these concepts in an efficient way. one of the points that Deming mentioned is the customer is the most important part of the production line. What he was trying to say is that whatever you do, whatever kind of work you're doing, or process you're doing, it doesn't matter if it's not appealing to the customer. The customer's reaction, their response has to be gauged accordingly. These concepts which were taught in the Lean Revolution, like for example, Toyota adapted it pretty well. Some of their concepts like just-in-time, minimized amount of waste, these were pretty practically deployed, and this is what led Toyota to be very successful in their industry, eventually not just dominating the Japanese market, but eventually penetrating the US market, which was mostly dominated by the US brands. Some of the learnings from this concept were taken up by Steve Lang, and that's where he came up with the customer development methodology. Now, those of you who are part of a technology background, who are familiar with many of the software development cycles, you will be familiar that many of the practices which were deployed in understanding customer requirements and building a software product stage by stage, it was turning out to be quite inefficient to a certain extent. I was discussing with certain people like Klaus over here in another networking session where there were certain ideologies like rapid application development, is that right? Yeah, and there was another one which you mentioned.
You talked about the use cases. That's more the unit for design of requirements and then develop software and see if it works the way the client wants it. So it's basically very close to what we had in the first few prototyping of yours.
True.
What you're going to talk about soon.
Yeah, true. So some of the ideas and concepts were applied over there, and what happened is they noticed that the traditional practices that they were following for software development were not very efficient. It was leading to way longer time of getting customer feedback. You were building things that customer did not want. And they tried to adapt accordingly to see how they could suit the customer's needs much more efficiently. And Steve Lang, from his experience in the industry, he came out with the customer development where it's divided into four stages. Basically, what he talks about is you go through a first phase where you discover who your customer is. You identify your target market segment. The second stage, whatever learnings you've had from the customer discovery phase, you validate it, you test it out, and you see whether it actually is something that the customer usually wants. This first half of the stage is known as validated learning. Once you move beyond stage, you then come to the execution part where you are creating something for the customer and eventually you're building the company. Now what I'm discussing about here is on a very high level overview. Those of you who have actually been familiar with the customer development, you know it actually entails a lot more details. But due to the limitation of time, I'm just keeping things at the high level. The lean startup concepts were basically deployed from a similar kind of thinking, where every entrepreneur goes to a stage where they have an idea and they want to test out the idea. They want to see whether this is something which is appealing to the customer, so they go ahead and they build it. In the high technology world, it's called like coding, where they actually build the program and then they measure accordingly what they have built by testing it out with the customer. And based on the feedback that they get from the data or the information that they have retrieved from customer feedback, they learn accordingly where they have gone wrong, and they again brainstorm the initial idea, and the cycle repeats all over. Basically, there's a term which comes across quite frequently, which is called pivoting. What pivoting actually talks about is that the initial idea that you started off with, the basic hypothesis, the vision that you originally had. As an entrepreneur, we tend to get very attached to our ideas. We like to think that this is the right way to go, but then if you go and test it out, you will find out eventually that whatever you're trying to build, it was not completely according to the customer's needs. you have to fine-tune your idea. Sometimes, what you're trying to build and what the customer wants are so drastically different that eventually you have to take, you come to a stage where you have to take a decision. Should I stick to my original idea or should I pivot? That is, should I change directions accordingly to meet the customer's needs so that it will be beneficial for the customer as well as beneficial for me in terms of building something else, investing my time and money in building something that people actually want. So that's the basic idea of the pivoting, where, and just to mention one more point, pivoting doesn't occur just once in your business cycle. It can occur multiple times, depending what kind of phase you're going through. It can be the defining moment between the odds of meeting success in your venture, and more importantly, you have to do it before you run out of whatever amount of money you have invested in your venture. The concept of how exactly a startup runs is basically the people, the initial founding team, it forms the crux of your entire hypothesis that you're testing, the people, the kind of talent that they bring along with them, the culture that you build within your organization. Culture in the sense you keep open access to information about the product. You keep knowledge sharing to all the members. There is no kind of a hidden personal agenda. The processes that you build in order to maintain this culture and also to maintain the flow of work. And finally, the accountability factor. That is, how do you measure what exactly your people are doing? How do you measure the progress of your product or service? Now, before I delve in further, there are a few myths that I just want to shatter here. These are common myths that many people have when they hear about the term lean or they hear about startup. Usually they think that lean is all about trying to save the amount of money. Not usually. Lean is about being quick. You are in an open market where you're competing with other firms, so you want to test your idea, your hypothesis, as quickly as possible, with minimum amount of time, and plus, without spending too much amount of money. As entrepreneurs, you could be bootstrapping, you could actually be funding yourself, or probably you could also be answerable to your investors who have put in their amount of money in your venture. The second myth is that the lean startup methodology is only for technology, internet companies, Web 2.0 firms, or consumer targeting companies. Not necessarily. See, any business, any idea which actually starts off with any segment, they start off with a similar kind of hunch, similar kind of doubts and questions which come in the mind as to who my customer is, how much should I actually spend to build a customer base, or what amount of features do I have to bring up with which can be appealing to my targeted customer base. Basically, it applies to all companies that face a similar kind of uncertainty as to what their customers want. The third myth is, it's only for bootstrap companies, entrepreneurs who are building their venture by financing from their own pocket. As I already explained, even if you are tied in with an investor who is actually putting a sum of money in your firm, you could basically apply these concepts to save the money which has been put in and not wasting the sufficient amount of capital. And finally, one of the doubts that founders have, well, whatever vision I'm having, I'm replacing that with just purely data from the customer and taking their feedback. Well, whatever I began with, the original idea, it no longer exists. Not necessarily. Your vision is still intact, it is there. But what you're doing is, you're testing your vision. You're testing whether certain elements of your vision that you thought could be brought into fruition Is it possible or not? And how you test that? You test it based on the feedback that you're getting from the customer. And accordingly, you see whether this vision is sustainable or not. Now, one of the ways to do it is you build a product which is with a minimum amount of features. What you're trying to do is, you're building a product or service which comes with basic features which can be tested out with a few set of early adopters, that is your initial customer base, whom you feel that will be quite tolerable in terms of your product not being perfect. They would like to poke around and see how it is. Like, for example, again, I can take off Facebook. Facebook began in the dormitory room. They started off with just universities, and they tested out a lot of the initial crucial features with the student community. And as they develop further, they then open the gates to the world. And now, even today, they're actually iterating. They're testing out new technologies. They are seeing how exactly the customers are reacting. Some of the reactions have not been very pleasant. I believe most of you are aware about the privacy issues. But at the end of the day, they are adapting according to the customer's need. And that's why still today, Facebook is the leading social network in the world. These so-called early evangelists, whom we call, are your visionary early adopters, your initial base of customers who have a set amount of belief that they feel that you're building something which can be of value to them, and they're ready to give it a try and give you their feedback so that you can build something better. And once you have come out with a much more superior product, you can then open it to the worldwide market. And most importantly, these customers, the initial set of customers, they will give you the crucial feedback whether what you're building is of sustainable value or not. Is it something that some people want? Rather than just going on full scale and spending all that amount of money in terms of marketing and all the other facets of your business, you're just testing it out on a minimum level basis. And you're maximizing the learning based on a few amount of dollars or dirhams that you're spending on the product itself. Now, one question is that how minimum is minimum? What's the minimum that you can go? One example I'll take from web startups. When they have an idea, they have an interesting thought. What they do is they build up a good landing page and they just give you the option to sign up with your email address. That itself gives them a good idea how many people are interested in their product or service. And that gives them a kind of initiative to understand whether this is something that we can dwell upon further. That's an example I can give to you as to how minimum can minimum actually be. Now, visionary customers, as I spoke already, they help fill in the gaps on missing features. They also help you to evaluate to see if your product solves a real problem. And most importantly, they allow you to achieve this within a small group of customers before you go large scale. And most importantly, as a founder, you have to have the commitment to bring about changes according to the feedback that you're getting regarding your service or product. Now, some of the fears that I'd like to address that founders have. First of all, we have an understanding that, you know, why would somebody actually go to try out a product which is very, very minimal? I mean, don't customers like to have a full-on ready product? Yeah, they do. And people do buy a full-on ready product, but you have to keep in mind that they buy it from trusted brands, companies which are having a certain amount of reputation in the market. You are completely new to the segment. You are trying to test out your idea. People don't know you. So why do you want to go full scale and burn a lot of time and money rather than starting off small and testing to see whether whatever you're building can be taken to a large scale? Another fear that they have is the visionary complex. mostly people relate to Steve Jobs' comment as customers don't know what they want. So why should I go about talking to customers in the first place? Let me build something. I mean, isn't that what Apple did? True. It is true that Steve Jobs said that, but you have to understand that Apple built a product which took several years down the lane to come out with different kinds of features. The iPhone came out in 2007. What people forget is that there was a product called iPod which was tested out initially. They saw how it appealed to music lovers, and based on that, they actually thought, why not test it out with building a phone, something which is unique from what other vendors and companies are trying to do. You have to understand that Apple wasn't the innovator or pioneer of mobile phones. There were other companies who were building smartphones. They just built it better. And based on the success of the iPhone, the iPad came out. Another thought is that, you know, I'm too busy to learn. Why would I go about spending my time trying to do all these measuring and everything when I can actually build the product and test it out and see? I mean, isn't customer delight the main objective, the ultimate goal? It is. Customer delight is the ultimate goal, but if you want to achieve that goal, why not do it in a more efficient way rather than just building based on your own hypothesis and not trying to understand what exactly the customer needs? Some of the principles that I applied at Lean Startup is topics like innovation accounting, which moves or dwells away from traditional accounting practices. They try to establish the baseline that is your minimal viable product, and they try to measure accordingly how customers behave according to what you've built in the product. You also try to fine-tune the engine. You experiment to see if you can improve whatever metrics you're using to measure your product. And more importantly, you decide based on those measurements or the feedback you receive whether to stick with your product or whatever you're building, that is, whether you want to persevere with that, or do you want to pivot according to whatever new feedback that you've got from your customers. There are certain books which have actually dwelled on this topic. Eric Ries has written in detail about the Lean Startup. Steve Blank has actually discussed about customer development in his book called The Four Steps to Epiphany. And there are other books which are written by web entrepreneurs, such as Running Lean, that is understanding the analytics, what it takes to run a high technology venture, as well as a summarized version of Steve Blank's concept, that is The Entrepreneur's Guide to Customer Development. Now, I understand for those of you who are already familiar with the concept, some of the things that I've spoken here are more at a high level overview. They are topics which can be discussed in more detail. Basically, the group which I initiated here in coordination with the original Lean Startup Circle, which is based in Silicon Valley, what we are actually trying to understand is what people here within Dubai, the business community or the budding entrepreneurs, what exactly they are looking to learn from their personal venture, and how exactly we can help in sharing the knowledge and helping you to succeed in your entrepreneurial venture by applying the Lean Startup process. So I'd like to keep the floor open to any kind of questions you have, and I'd like to keep this a two-way interaction where I'd appreciate if you give me your feedback as to what exactly you're looking to build and what kind of goals you're trying to pursue, so we can plan out our future events accordingly to what entrepreneurs are looking for. Anyone would like to start off? Yeah, Pat.
Yeah, Sanjay here.
Yeah.
I just want to know, when you say startup, essentially there could be two categories. Just help me if the understanding is right.
Yeah.
One startup says that I'm an innovator, that's why I'm a startup. Build something new does not exist in the landscape.
Yeah.
Or somebody says, I'm still a startup, then something is existing around in the landscape. There are people around, there's competition around, and I feel I can do it better.
True.
So would the roadmap for both these guys would be different? And the approach would be different?
Yes, it could be different. When you're talking about...
When you want to apply the lean, in the context of applying lean, because I could still start a business when there are already marketplaces crowded.
Yeah.
Or I could think of an innovation, because that's a different life cycle I think. I think we can share our experience.
To be honest with you, the lean methodology can be applied in both phases. When you're talking about bringing out something new to the market, first of all, as I mentioned earlier, you're trying to identify who your customers are. So you're trying to test out and see whether these customers are the ones, the right people that you're targeting. And secondly, the product or service you're trying to build, is it something that will be appealing to them in the first place?
Yeah, and my question is more specific, saying that would the entrepreneur take a different approach of applying the lean in both scenarios, or would it be
different approach in the sense?
Like applying the lean principles here.
Mm-hmm.
When he's either an innovator or he's replicating some business but trying to do it better.
Yeah,
there could be always very less innovator, let's agree. Not everybody comes out with true innovation.
True.
But would the lean methodologies be applied in a similar way? Or is there some guidelines which say, okay, if you're an innovator, probably this is the path you should take, where your product development or service development is more of a focus? Whereas if you're an existing player in the market, it is a different way to approach the...
See, to give you a straightforward answer, lean methodology, the concepts, the principles, is unique to each and every startup. Yeah. You're running a startup based on, let's say, if someone's trying to build a social network, for example, whatever testing they'll do, it'll be totally different. If someone is trying to build a hardware, the testing of that hardware will be totally different from what you do for a software-based method. But the principles that are being used here, it will be the same. But how you apply it, it will be unique to your business. Yes, Klaus.
I follow that what you did is pretty much in line with Eric Mises' views.
Yeah.
On the second slide, I think it says extreme uncertainty. Now, if you decide to open a hairdressing saloon and you improve certain things, you know people need hairdressing. This is not extreme uncertainty. There are things that go way beyond the product definition. Like, for example, Facebook as the example for extreme uncertainty. Who is the client of Facebook? And I ask you, who is the client of Facebook? Anybody willing to answer?
Advertisers,
exactly. Yeah. Facebook attracts millions of eyeballs. That is the value of Facebook for people who want to place adverts. So that's a new business model. That's a different revenue model. Social networking was not new. But the way they managed to attract huge amounts of people presented a value to a new client segment that so far was not addressed. That was where the extreme uncertainty came from. Maybe some of you use those things called PCs.
Yeah.
What was extreme uncertainty? The development of DOS as an operating system for the very first PCs. And Gates and his friends were successful in selling that before it even existed. They found paying customers. So the minimum viable product back then was a concept. Same thing with the company that ceased to exist, SUN, Sun Microsystems. SUN stood for Stanford University Network. They sold workstations before they had the product, which goes back into the concept of minimal viable product. You have an idea, you have a vision, but you don't have the money to build it. But you find people who are willing to say, yes, I'm willing to pay for that, and not as an investor, but as a paying client, which is what I believe is crucial about the lean startup mechanism. You try to get as early as possible to people who say, I'm willing to pay. That part is what is so different about it. As traditionally, conventionally, big companies tend to have big idea about strategy, and then they try to find out if this goes, but they invest huge amounts of money to build a product and then find out if the customers are actually willing to buy that. I like your Inuit example with Quicken. They were a well-established company to provide software. They actually started with an idea to build something to gain wide acceptance. They ended up building something different. They ended up using mobile phones and cameras in the smartphones to take photoshots of tax declarations and filled it in the back end, completely different to the idea they had initially. That's an existing company that used lean mechanisms to build innovation into future products, which I believe is the final answer to your question.
Absolutely.
I believe, Jane, you have a point?
Yeah, I wanted to probably add on top of what he said. My name is Jamie, I'm an entrepreneur and a lean startup practitioner for almost 2 years now. And you've mentioned the word hypothesis. And something which probably wasn't there on the presentation, but it's useful, is the concept of business model. I don't know if who of you guys are aware of that, and specifically the business model canvas. And it's a nice way to kind of visualize, understand that when it comes to companies, there are several hypotheses. There is more than one. Yeah.
True.
And there are nine of them. Yeah. One of them is a product. Yeah. Another one is who's the customer, and there are other seven of those. So when it comes to who's a startup, who's not a startup, it comes down to how many of those nine assumptions you've already validated. Yeah. So if it's not as trivial as just ticking boxes, but if you are just ticking the first two or three or four, it means that you still haven't found not only the product, but the actual business model. Yeah. So when you are ahead in the game and you've ticked, let's say, most of them, you could say that you are no longer a startup. You've found your business model, and then you are going full speed executing that business model. Then you kind of relabeled yourself, although this is kind of unnecessary or it doesn't make any difference. But then you become like a established organization, an established company.
I believe this is what you're talking about.
Yeah. And also wanted to de-emphasize the technology angle that we are applying to this concept. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know, well, probably later we will know who is doing what here, but I would argue that not everyone is doing internet related or technology related products. Yeah, so it's cool when we can find examples of that come from different place. Yeah, so and that also helps us to understand the concepts much better, I would argue.
True. When I mentioned technology, it wasn't basically I was trying to emphasize that it's only for technology ventures. Even if you're trying to build a certain service, let's say you're trying to build a database over here about a local community, particular, like let's say for example when Dubism must have started. They would have started with trying to understand what exactly people wanted. But ultimately, when they build that, they build it on the web technology. That's what maybe I was trying to say.
Yeah, I think just always kind of think of this, try to find like very odd examples. For example, what could be an innovation in the ice cream business?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So one could be, so, okay, how could I deliver ice cream? It's something that hasn't been done before, so probably it's a problem that it's been there for a long time. People want to be refreshed when they are feeling thirsty or hot. But if they are not close to an ice cream shop, then how can someone satisfy that need? And then you can come with a proper innovation, which has nothing to do with computers or programming or anything. And you can refer to it as a true innovation in the way you can package ice cream so it keeps its temperature for longer. Yeah, so that's innovation, and it's an ice cream business.
Yeah, sure.
Just building on Jamie and Klaus's points, I think for the future session, what would be really useful for everyone, I'm just talking on behalf of everyone, is that if we probably work on or discuss maybe case studies, maybe of success stories and maybe of failures, I think it would help a lot more. Because rather than what I like about this versus, you know, any other methodology is that this is, you can only understand it by practicing.
Of course.
And the only way, you know, we can get the hang of practicing, or you know what to practice, or even know what we're talking about, or learn the methodologies, is working, you know, on cases and discussing.
Not just reading blogs.
No, you can't do that. You just can't.
Of course.
So maybe that's just something.
Knowledge applied. You would like to see knowledge applied. So if you have some kind of placeholder, you say these are successful case studies.
Yeah.
Some people who deny knowledge.
Pat, do you have a point?
Yeah. No debate on the framework. We use it professionally with our startups. As much as you think you can apply it to that, the interpretation of the information that's largely required and how you can take things to market. But for me personally, will this group, this circle, Lean Startup Circle, be a community that exchanges information, experiences and things like that? Or is it about teaching people about the business model?
Okay. It is a bit of both. Basically, some people are not completely familiar with these concepts. These concepts can be learned online as well. We have lots of resources. But we don't mind conducting sessions where we actually introduce people to the concept. And at the same time, as you mentioned, sharing other people's experiences with regard to the concepts that they applied from their own business ventures. I've already been in talks with different entrepreneurs here who have already set up successful ventures. They have had it up and running. They're actually generating revenue from that. And they use similar kind of models and principles to actually build their business. And they're willing to come and talk about it. At the same time, the Lean Startup Circle, which is based in the Valley, they are looking to see the interest of entrepreneurs here, what they'd like to know. And accordingly, they'd like to coordinate online streaming sessions. Maybe we could do it over here itself, where people have knowledge exchange with experienced entrepreneurs, and they can also learn from their experience how to apply some of the concepts that they've used and maybe certain ideas they're having.
So what do they offer as an organization to their community? Is it like a forum, some blog space? Is it, you said it, a question before,
yeah.
They've tried, like probably many in this part of the world, tried to enter the market.
Yeah.
Was it that they did not succeed because they didn't have physical representation here? And a lot of things need to be driven physically here. What were the factors?
Well, they didn't go into much detail, but one point that they mentioned that they tried to conduct workshops, which basically they, maybe it was too expensive, or maybe it was not targeted to the right segment. So they tried to understand that first you have to see what people are actually looking out for here, and then build accordingly and support the community over here. Coming to your question as to how they are applying to support, as I said, it's a grassroots community. It's more about peer-to-peer mentorship. So you could have people who are already well established in their field of endeavor. They will be actually speaking to you via an online streaming session. If they will be, we'll be conducting sessions where if people have certain idea, they have certain products that they're working on, they can actually learn from some of the principles taught about it, and they can apply it and come back with their findings, how exactly their progress has been. Basically, the objective is not to just talk about your product, but to talk about the learnings that you've had from the methodologies that you applied. And even if you have faced any kind of hurdles, the community will be actually supporting you, trying to give them your feedback as to where exactly you might be going wrong. And from their experience, we have entrepreneurs over here who have been based over here for quite a while. They have some certain amount of wisdom that they would like to share, which might be helpful for people who are just starting off.
I would say that, yeah, that the success of the group comes down to balancing what you kind of mentioned, which is how much effort do we spend kind of getting everyone like up to speed with more or less the same level of understanding.
Yeah.
And also how can we share our own experiences so people can just chip in with their common sense.
Yeah.
And learn from what the person that's sharing is sharing, and vice versa, how that person can learn from the common sense of a bigger group. So I think it comes down to finding the balance of those two. I attempted to run a group like this before, and probably the assumption that I had at the time, it was like a year ago, was that there was a community that were up to speed when it comes to the concepts. So we can, so we could have a conversation that was of a certain level, but it started from a certain place. But then I quickly realized that wasn't the case.
Yeah.
So it does make sense to make some effort trying to bring the group on to a certain level. So I'm pretty sure that from then on, things will get very interesting and very.
That's an interesting point. See, the reason why I actually sent across a survey, just trying to understand what people were actually trying to look for, I got a few responses. Some of them were like, you know, new to the concept, we were just trying to understand. I was hoping to get feedback from some of the people already established and running. Basically, why I have actually kept this for a second is to, first of all, understand where exactly people stand over here in terms of understanding the Lean Startup principles, and eventually in any new area, in any new region, you have to first see and assess like what level the people are in terms of understanding of the concepts, and then build it from there on, rather than just starting off a workshop and trying to charge people. So your point is absolutely valid. We actually, that's the objective of this meeting today, to see and to spread the word around to fellow entrepreneurs who may have not been able to actually make it today, as to what exactly people are looking to learn and what are the first things that you'd actually like to start off, so that the next event which is coming in, it will be better oriented to maybe whatever feedback you've got over here, and if we have people who have been coordinating with in Lean Startup Arabia, in Lean Startup Saudi, as well as some of the other regions who are actually willing to come down and actually discuss from their experiences from this book. Yeah.
If you're not a startup, if you're an established company with established products,
yeah,
but you're interested in finding new ways or new mediums to reach your target audience, can you apply these principles?
Oh, yes, you can, as I mentioned. Sorry about that. Yeah, as I mentioned that, yes, you definitely can. That's why I began the conversation talking about entrepreneurs, people within the organization who'd like to apply the ideas. In fact,
even a new product, just kind of, not even a new product, just kind of trying to find new ways to reach consumers, to engage with them, but in a way that it's
yes,
not going to cost you an arm and a leg.
You can. In fact, there are organizations which are doing that today. Yeah, Jake.
Yeah, I would say that it comes down to, I think the whole theory comes down to what's your assumption and what experiments can you put forward to validate them.
Yeah.
So you can then think on in those terms. So if you are probably trying to investigate a new communication channel, then that's your hypothesis. What experiment can you run that can give some information to kind of know if that if pursuing that path makes sense or not. Yeah. So it comes down to that. It's can you frame a hypothesis? Can you come up with an experiment to validate it? Can you actually go and interview the people you want to reach out to see if that channel of communication is relevant to them? And that's it. And then you are applying by default Lean Startup. You don't have to cover by that even. It's just that sense of running experiments.
It also depends on the initiative of your management, how supportive they are. That point. Yeah, Klaus.
Yeah, that's in line with what I like to say. One of the key issues is how to drive innovation in a well-established organization. And quite often you are bound by budgetary constraints, you are bound by processes, you are bound by mindset. And that is why there is actually a school of thought that says for a well-established major organization to drive innovation, they have to set up a new company that has to be completely independent of the existing one, and there needs to be a budget that exists for a runtime of, let's say, 2 years at the minimum, where they do not have to obey the regular profitability rules. As otherwise, there is no experiment that you can actually apply. So there are organizations that work on that, and you mentioned Clayton Christensen. There's also innovative solution.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of mindset around that, and I personally believe that as part of this discussion, what is the scope of this group here, it may be of interest to establish a common ground of understanding or knowledge, but then to go into how much is truly a startup in the sense of young entrepreneur starts with a vision and goes somewhere, and how much is about a company that has grown to a certain size. Apple did not start to exist with iPod. They existed way before.
Yeah.
And they went through major issues when they had management changes, and only once Steve Jobs was called back into the company, they went back to certain principles, which all is part of how to drive innovation in a major organization. And that is where the business canvas is actually missing the bottom layer, which is principles and values.
Yes, ma'am. When you were asking the question what we'd be looking for, sorry, I don't know what you have in mind, so I would say what I would be looking for. I see some people here, not all of us are serial entrepreneurs, so
yeah.
It's good to talk about a certain way of doing a startup,
true.
But it's easy for us to cross the line and become a very traditional entrepreneur, not using the lean startup. So I like the methodology. I come from a consulting background where I was an Lean Six Sigma practitioner, so I like this methodology. I like to have like other entrepreneurs to say, okay, I'm going this way, am I following this principle, or do you think I'm crossing the line and going into too much traditional? Let's say, for example, I'm about to spend $10,000 on marketing campaign. You would, maybe some of you can tell, well, according to where you are, you're not doing like a new startup. So, well, just to sum up, what I'll be looking for is to make sure that I can talk with other people to be sure that we are sticking to this methodology and not mixing with other methodology or pretending that we're using the Lean Startup methodology while I'm using
absolutely
something different.
Absolutely, that's the idea. See, as I mentioned, whether you are someone who's starting off new or whether you are already having something established, you can apply these principles accordingly. But at the end of the day, what we are trying to achieve here, that to conduct the future sessions, we'd like to know like if any kind of understanding that people like to have, they want to basically start off with maybe an introductory to a certain kind of teaching about Eric Ries' principle, they would like to first have understanding, you want to go step by step, we are willing to do that as well. Yeah.
There is an online course in Udemy, which
yeah.
was designed and produced by Steve Lamp himself.
Yes.
It's mind blowing. It's really high production value, and that guy has. What's cool about him is that he's learned how to explain these in very simple terms.
True.
And that's the strength of his approach, and it's free. Yeah, so it's literally anyone can just go online, and it takes a while. It's a chain of I don't know 30, 40 videos. Each of the videos is like 3 or 4 minutes long. It's whatever chapters, but if you go through that, then it really opens your eyes, and you're ready for business because it's so well explained that you just after that you just go and do things for yourself.
One of our members had shared that in the comments, if those are not been seen, they shared the link to the video as well. In fact, I will reshare that once again, so those of you who are new to the concept will at least be familiar with what exactly it is about. Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, I understand this group is fairly new, so it takes time to evolve.
Yes.
I think what will ensure that people are bound to this is some kind of quantification, if you can build it over a period of time. People can understand something which works.
Okay.
So we have a theory which will get evolved and explained to a lot of people. So let's say, if you're able to say that by applying this new methodology, my go-to-market time reduced by 30%.
Yeah.
Okay. My product innovation cost instead of X became Y.
Yes.
And if you can connect the quantification, people will start appreciating the benefit of the model.
Maybe
rather than keeping it,
as you mentioned,
it has to get quantified. So maybe it will evolve. I know it's too early probably. But I think if you cannot quantify, people cannot connect.
Of course.
People think, I think it looks good, it sounds good, but how does it affect me? And like, you know, it says, somebody said, you tell a person there are 1 million stars in the sky, he will believe it.
Yeah.
But you tell the person that the bench on which he is going to sit is wet, he will touch his hand and see. Because that affects him.
Of course.
There are a million stars in the sky. You know.
And that's a good answer.
So we should quantify. And if we don't quantify, I mean, you know, it doesn't work. And this, it will not be sustainable.
Yeah.
A lot of people will say, oh, I think it's abstract. I am running my show. As I said, it's a conventional entrepreneurship. He said, I don't know what is lean and all. Connect me just to quantification. Same in that, okay, it helps me. I went to market fast. I cut down my cost. I could hire better employees.
Yeah.
Something. You have to evolve. I don't have any answer right now, but I think we should get there.
No, I absolutely agree with
Otherwise,
you.
Otherwise, it will become one more theory kind of stuff.
True. I absolutely agree with you. That's the reason why I kickstarted this event, first of all, sort of, to understand where exactly people stand and what exactly you're looking to actually learn from this. I could see many people have taken interest. They were excited to see such a kind of group being formed over here.
Which is very good.
Initially, we have to basically understand what people want to learn. If you're going to do certain kind of initiatives which are not appealing, I mean, again, applying on the lean startup base as well, if you're not targeting in the right way, obviously the interest will fade. So that's why the future events, as I said, it's all based on feedback which I get from people, give what they're looking for. And probably, yes, as you said, bring in an example, as Shikha mentioned, make a case study of maybe already established and successfully running idea, which is deploy these principles and see how exactly people can compare it. I absolutely agree. Yeah?
Just have a question or comment. How is this different than the concept, especially with companies?
Would you like to try?
I can have a try, but I never apply this one. Theory and the books.
Yeah.
The Lean Six Sigma methodology used in the industry is mostly to reduce the waste. So if you have to produce whatever it is, and I will give you like a very simple example, you have to keep a cake, the way that you get all the raw materials out of the fridge and put it on the table and not go back and forth more many times to open the fridge, take the milk, close the fridge, put the milk in the and go back, open the fridge, take the chocolate, and just put everything next to each other. You have like several steps, you have just make the steps closer, and you have lean. In fact, lean is in every day. Everything that makes sense is kind of lean in day-to-day life.
I can add to that
it
as
is
well.
Based, yeah.
And it is, there are two basic things. One is obviously to reduce the waste, make things lean, and the second part is to save money. So there's a lot of, I used to do that. A lot of emphasis on saving money. So any process that has variation, you know, it could be anything that has failures. So you measure, you know, 3.6 failures per million, and anything that just goes away from the norm. How do you streamline that? And that's the focus, basically, and saving money. Whereas it's all about making something that exists better. But this is something doesn't exist, and you're figuring out a way how to start it by using the best resource optimization that you possibly can.
Yeah.
And making sure that you're not building something that somebody doesn't want. So it's completely different, I would say. It's just the word lean is what confuses people. Yeah.
As I said, the beginning, the myth, you know, it's about cheap.
Because lean in Six Sigma, Lean Six Sigma means cutting the fat. That is really what they mean by lean, right? Like, so take steak, and you know, take the leanest meat that you can. But this is not it. This is not what they mean by lean.
Just a few, can I have everyone's attention, please? Sorry, just a few difficulties because it's already a post that GM had already enrolled and has watched those videos, so the essential videos have been skipped. And since we are running short of time, I know that people are having other plans. It's like almost close to 9 p.m. What I'll do is I will share the link with everyone. The website is Udacity and it's free to enroll for everyone. It will give a good introduction to everyone on Steve Lang's customer development methodology and what he spoke about over here. And in the meanwhile, as I'd just like to reiterate the objective of the group, there will be a few questions from different members as to what the group is going to be about. So I just want to mention that, as already some of us discussed over here, that it's not just about knowledge, just reading theoretical principles, but actually practicing whatever you're learning. And more importantly, this is not going to be a kind of an accelerator or an incubation hub. We are just trying to be a peer-to-peer mentorship group, and we're trying to be a complementary asset to existing incubators and accelerators here who are already having a network of entrepreneurs who are in contact with them. And most of the feedback that we are planning to do in terms of future sessions is not on the product that you're just trying to build, it's the methodology that you're deploying in terms of achieving whatever you want in terms of your product or service. And it's not just about talking about what features you're trying to build, it's the assumptions that you have in your mind with regard to your idea, whatever field of endeavor you're in, and to test out those assumptions to see whether they're right or not. And more importantly, this is not a venue where you're going to come and pitch to potential investors or anything. It's, as I said, it's a community for entrepreneurs to come and learn from each other, to brainstorm your idea. And yeah, lastly, to get feedback on business model as well. And one last point I'd just like to highlight, I'm not sure if most of you actually got to see some of the latest comments which came from certain users in the last few days. This group that we are trying to build here in coordination with Lean Startup Circle Silicon Valley, it is not about one particular individual and it is not about anyone's personal agenda. It's a group which is going to benefit all the members of the community, all the members of the group. What we're looking for is basically volunteers who would like to help organize a group. Today, I have actually kickstarted the event. Tomorrow, it can be taken further by many other interested fellow entrepreneurs. I mean, this is how the circle actually began in different parts of the world. The initial pioneers of the group, basically, they generated the interest and they were more passionately driven members of the group who have taken the community further. So, as I understand, this is the first event and I was just trying to understand what people who are coming in here, what they're trying to look for. It was pretty valuable, the feedback they've given to me. And I hope that in the next coming future events, I'll get to see more of the familiar faces and some new members as well. And hopefully the group, as we are discussing with some of the members here during the break, the group will eventually shape up and we will try to understand what exactly people are trying to achieve. And hopefully we'll be able to deliver it, not just from wisdom of entrepreneurs who are based outside the region, but people who are established here within the Dubai circle as well. So I thank you for your time, and I really appreciate that you all took the moment to come down here. I'll just answer questions. I'll be sending across a brief survey to everyone. I appreciate that if you can please provide your feedback. I know everyone's busy, but it won't take more than a minute of your time. It'll be important for me as well as for the people with whom I'm coordinating so as to understand what people are looking to actually learn from this group, and will help us to make much more fruition-based future events. Yeah. Yeah, thank you.
One question regarding the frequency. What do you have in mind? The weekly, monthly, quarterly, or demand?
Well, as of now, the next event which will take place, it will be towards the end of June. So yeah, it will be monthly. But based on the interest and the feedback I'm getting from people, and depending on how many entrepreneurs I'm having who are going to come up here and share their experiences as well, it could vary. It could become bi-monthly or it could become a weekly event. It all depends on the interest of the community and how quickly the word spreads out. Yeah.
Any questions? Depends on how quickly the people are adopting. So, not necessarily every week needs to come on the same level.
Sorry?
I think it also depends on how quickly the people are able to solve these concepts, because as you rightly said, it's a mix of people have different
backgrounds
and knowledge levels. So the earlier we probably are able to go through those, let's say, videos,
yeah,
and as well as learn the concepts.
Yeah.
I'm assuming there will be more productive sessions.
See, that's a very good point you mentioned. In fact, that's something I want to highlight as well. The development of the community depends on the initiatives and the efforts of the members as well. If you're looking purely purely for a session where we just have any member come and talk about the experience. At the end of the day, you're just coming and listening to a monotonous talk. The idea is to have mutual exchange between all members, people participating. Maybe there might be sessions where we are setting forward goals, like people have to go and learn certain, like for example, now I'm going to share the Udacity course with Steve Lang. It'll be good to see if everyone actually completes the course and understands what exactly the basic methodology is all about. At the end of the day, it depends on your efforts as well, how much of initiative people take, and when you come back to the group, your knowledge exchange, whatever peer-to-peer information you are actually exchanging with people, that will be beneficial not just for you, but also for fellow members of the group. I hope I'm being very clear about this. At the end of the day, the group is as good as the initiatives being taken by the people, actually, to improve your own knowledge and basically come back and contribute back to the group.
As of now, this is going
to be an official chapter of the Lean Startup Circle, but yes, I agree with you. To give a complete clear vision what exactly the group is intending to achieve and for any new people coming, yes, I definitely agree with that. Yeah.
Also, I think going forward, there's a startup has only one person, so he only has that much of knowledge which he knows.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of knowledge which is around here in this room. So we can probably have practical breakout sessions. We'll probably have the first 15 minutes of the next meetup as a video or learning kind of a theory class.
Yeah.
And then a person can present his idea or have a breakout session. So people who are, whatever the nine values, I don't know them what they are. But let's say one is innovation. So people who are more innovative here can be part of that group. So the idea can, let's say I'm presenting, I can talk to the people who are innovative.
Yeah.
And they give a feedback about the 1 minute presentation that I did. And then I can move to a next desk, which probably be continuity of business or sustainability, whatever. So you could have breakout sessions and then people actually can get a real insight, because the whole group, as I understand, is about knowledge sharing and exchange of new methodology and putting it fast. So a guy who's got an idea, like I have an idea today, I can do that in probably 2-3 weeks because I've met the nine, whatever.
I completely follow.
So we have a more practical breakout session.
Yeah.
Rather than just theory. That's what
I completely follow what you're saying, and that's the idea of the group. As I said, these points I mentioned, it's not just about what you read and you just come and share based on knowledge you've gained. It's what you've gone and done outside.
Yeah.
And that's the idea. See, these nine stages that you mentioned, it's not necessarily to be done in one session alone. Probably you will do a few bit of experimentation,
yes,
and you'll share your feedback. The group will give you your thoughts as well. And you'll need some time to go and test it out for them and come back.
Yeah.
So it all depends according to the person, how quickly they are able to go and test out their ideas and how frequently they iterate basically. Yeah. Any other points? No? Okay. Great, thanks a lot for your time, and I hope to actually see you all again in the next event, and I'll keep everyone updated. The entire session was recorded in video, so if you want to share it with your friends, please feel free to do so once I provide it. Alright, thank you very much.